Morning, everyone. Today we are starting the second class of sixth session by Dr. Vidya CS. Today, ma'am will be dealing with the topic blood circulation in central nervous system. Before the session starts, I call Radhima and team to deliver the prayer.
वंदितं पादपादयं लोके जरालोके मृत्युनाशं दादार्यशं विविधौषधीनां धन्वन्त्री रमानाथं सर्वरोगे प्रवक्तारं वन्दे पीयूषं दायकं सर्वे जना सुखिनो भवन्तु सर्वे सन्तु निरामयाः ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति
Good morning, ma'am.
Yes, good morning.
So I hope you had a great day with us yesterday.
Yes.
Yeah, ma'am. So the platform is all yours. You can start your class.
Just give me 2 minutes. I'll sit
down. Yeah, ma'am. Sure.
Good morning, students. Hello, I'm audible?
Yeah, ma'am, you are audible, ma'am.
Okay, today I'll be briefing about the blood supply of brain as well as morphology of cerebellum and its functions. So blood supply of brain is very important as because without the blood supply or oxygen supply to the brain, you cannot be conscious and you cannot be coordinating any other activities. So the brain receives mainly about 15% of blood supply and accounts for 25% of body's oxygen consumption. So if it is 20 seconds of brain ischemia, it causes seizure cerebral activity of the brain. That means there's no coordination, you'll be subconscious, and ultimately the ischemia, or if it lasts for more than 1 hour, it leads to comatose condition. So the brain receives arterial supply from two pairs of vessels, what we call as internal carotid artery and vertebral arteries. So the internal carotid artery is coming from the subclavian artery from the neck, and vertebral artery also is coming from the first part of the subclavian artery. So these two forms what we call a circle of Willis in the base of the brain. So internal carotid artery supplies 80% of the forebrain, that's telencephalon and diencephalon. Then vertebral artery supplies 20% mainly to the brainstem and cerebellum, along with some other cortical regions. So this is the two arteries. So the internal carotid artery coming from the common carotid artery, then vertebral artery coming from the first part of the subclavian artery. So this carotid artery ascends upwards without giving any branches in the neck, and it goes to the carotid canal to foramen lacerum, and it winds round and forms a siphon here, is or a S-shaped bend. So the two vertebral arteries come from the first part of the plane artery. It passes to the transverse process or the transverse foramen of the cervical vertebra, and it passes to the foramen magnum to form what we call as basilar artery. That means the two vertebral arteries form the basilar artery. So this is the terminal branch of common carotid artery. It traverses the carotid canal, and it is got mainly what we call as petrous part, cervical part, and the intercarotid intercranial part. So this is the common carotid artery, and this is the intercarotid artery. In the neck, the branches are given only by the external carotid artery, not by the internal. And this intercarotid artery also traverses through the cavernous sinus before entering into the foramen or carotid foramen. So intracranially it passes horizontally forward along the floor and the medial wall of cavernous sinus, and turns upwards and enters the subarachnoid space below the optic nerve. So it mainly pierces the perforated substances and gives two important branches, what we call as anterior and middle cerebral arteries. The two important divisions are anterior and middle cerebral arteries, which also contribute to the formation of cerebellar villus. So this is the foramen lacerum through which the intercarotid artery emerges into the intracranial cavity. And within this petrous part of temporal bone, you find the carotid canal. So it has got two bends, we'll call as carotid siphon. So carotid siphon dampen the arterial pulsation and provides regular stream of blood supply to the brain. So as I told you, the carotid intercarotid artery has got four parts. One is called a cervical part, which is the neck, then the petrous part, within the petrous part of the temporal bone, then the cavernous part, within the cavernous, and the cerebral part. Cerebral part is forming the circle of Willis. So what are the main important branches of this intercarotid artery? So the first branch is called as ophthalmic artery. So ophthalmic artery mainly supplies the eyeball. Then you have the posterior communicating artery. The posterior communicating artery communicates the two posterior cerebral arteries. Then you have the anterior choroidal artery. The anterior choroidal artery pierces the substance of the brain to supply the lateral ventricle. Then coming to the vertebral artery. So the vertebral artery again is not mainly the four parts, but the first part arising from the first part of the plane artery, the neck cord, it passes to the cervical vertebra from the C7 to C6 to C1. It is the first part of second part of the in the vertebral artery. Then from the in the C1, it is the third part, and one entering into the fourth foramen magnum is the fourth part. It winds from the arch of atlas, and both the sides, both the vertebral arteries, they form basilar artery on the basilar part of the pons. So the first part of the plane artery passes from C6 to C1, then winds along the lateral mass of atlas, and then enters into the foramen magnum, turns upward, forward, medially, to join the opposite basilar artery to form the opposite vertebral artery from the basilar artery. So what are the main branches of this vertebral artery? See, you can make out here in this spinal cord. So throughout the length of spinal cord, it gives anterior and posterior spinal arteries, which mainly supply the spinal cord. So cervical part, mainly muscular and radicular branches, which supplies the cervical part of spinal cord. The cranial part, as I told you, anterior spinal artery and posterior spinal artery. Then you have the posterior inferior cerebellar artery, which is the largest branch of vertebral, which mainly supplies the cerebellar hemisphere as well as medulla. So this is the branches image showing. So the these are two vertebral arteries. You can make out this anterior and posterior spinal arteries on either side of the fissure of the spinal cord. Then you have the posterior inferior cerebellar artery supplying the cerebellum. And then you have the anterior inferior cerebellar artery, which also supplying the inferior surface of the cerebellum. Then you have the labyrinthine artery. These labyrinthine arteries are the minute branches which supplies the internal ear. Then you have the pontine arteries supplying the pons. Then superior cerebellar artery supplying the pons, superior cerebellar peduncle, and the inferior colliculus of the medulla. Then you have the important artery forming the circular filius, what you call as posterior cerebral artery. So the important branches of this vertebral arteries are anterior posterior spinal arteries, posterior inferior cerebellar artery, anterior cerebellar artery, the labyrinthine artery, pontine arteries, superior cerebellar, and posterior cerebral. So if it is supplying the cerebellum, it's called a cerebellar, and if it is supplying the cerebrum or the cerebral cortex, it's called as cerebral arteries. Coming to the anterior cerebral artery. So anterior cerebral artery is a branch coming from the inferior carotid artery. So it passes medially above the optic nerve, then passes into the greater longitudinal fissure between the frontal lobe, and it mainly communicates with the anticommunicating artery. So this anterior cerebral artery mainly supplies the medial surface of the cerebral cortex. So you can see various branches supplying the frontal lobe, parietal lobe, as well as the part of occipital lobe also. So the branches of this anterior cerebral artery are mainly, what as I told you, orbital branch, then you have the frontopolar branch, then you have the callosomarginal branch. All these branches supply the medial surface of the cerebrum. So it can be divided into cortical and central branches also, which supplies the frontal lobe, cerebral cortex, and till the parieto-occipital sulcus. So the agent which is brightened up is the branches of the anterior cerebral artery. So that is the frontopolar, then callosomarginal, then the paracentral artery. Now coming to the middle cerebral artery, which is also a branch of internal carotid artery, is the largest branch of the three cerebral arteries, which mainly supplies the superior lateral surface of the brain. So it passes along the lateral sulcus and ascends upwards and supplies the superior lateral surface, the frontal, parietal, and temporal lobes. Major lobes, or what we yesterday I told you, the major areas, what we call as speech area, then Broca's area, then hearing area, all our auditory cortex is all supplied by the superior, by the middle cerebral artery. What are branches from the middle cerebral artery? Main important branch in the middle cerebral artery is called as Charcot's artery, which is most common for the cerebral hemorrhage. And the main other branches are mainly anterior branch, then orbitofrontal branch, then anterior posterior parietal branch, and angular branch. These are the branches supplying the superior lateral surface of the cerebral hemisphere. But the medial strip of the superior lateral surface is supplied by anterior cerebral artery, and the most posterior part or the occipital lobe will be supplied by the posterior cerebral artery. So cerebral thrombosis commonly affects the middle cerebral vein or the middle cerebral artery, which is a direct continuation of inferior carotid artery. And what we call as contralateral anesthesia, any anesthesia involving face and arm due to involvement of motor and sensory area. So as I told you, the function areas. So if these function areas will be hampered or estimated from the thrombosis of these vessels, it leads to loss of speech or motor activities. So coming to the posterior cerebral artery, the posterior cerebral artery is the terminal branch of the basilar artery. It comes around the cerebri of the midbrain and being the corpus callosum, and mainly supplies the occipital lobe of the cerebral hemisphere. So what are the branches of posterior cerebral artery? Mainly it is posterior lateral and the posterior choroidal, then cortical and phalangine branches. All these mainly supplies the visual area, that is area number 17, 18 and 19. So to summarize the blood supply of the cerebral cortex, so most of the superior surface is supplied by the middle cerebral artery, except for a strip on the superior part, that is supplied by anterior cerebral artery, and the posterior part is supplied by posterior cerebral artery. Coming to the base of the brain, most medial part is supplied by the middle cerebral artery, then lateral part is supplied by the anterior cerebral artery, and posterior part by the posterior cerebral artery. So here in the medial surface, the majority is supplied by anterior cerebral artery, and partly this one is supplied by posterior cerebral artery, supplies the major part of visual area, both primary and secondary visual areas. Coming to the artery supply to the brain stem, as I told you, the vertebral arteries, and these supplies the medulla, and basilar artery supplies the pons. Midbrain is supplied by posterior cerebral artery coming from the basilar artery. Coming to circle of Willis, very, very important. The circle of Willis has been named as it was invented by Willis. It looks like a spider web. It looks like a spider web, and it is present at the base of the brain. So mainly what we learned to now, that is the two systems, an intercalated artery and two vertebral system, they form the circle of Willis. So anteriorly, it is formed by anterior cerebral artery, which is communicated by the anterior communicating artery, then middle cerebral artery, then posteriorly by the posterior communicating artery, which joins the posterior cerebral arteries. So this entire thing forms a circle of Willis. What are the functions of it? We need to equalize the blood flow, and it's a common site for aneurysms. Mainly the terminal part of the intercalated artery and anticoagulating artery proximal to middle cerebral artery are prone for aneurysms. What is aneurysm? It's looking for dilatation of the vessel. So what are the branches from the circle of Willis? So mainly it has been categorized as anterior medial group, then anterior lateral group, posterior medial group, and posterior lateral group. These in turn supply the important nuclei on cortical regions of the cerebrum. So the anterior medial group mainly supplies the hypothalamus. The anterior lateral group supplies the corpus striatum and internal capsule. So internal capsule, one of the important white matter. Then posterior medial group mainly supplies thalamus, hypothalamus, and as well as pituitary gland. In posterior lateral group, from the posterior cerebral supplies the thalamus. Coming to venous drainage. So when we talk about blood supply, both arterial as well as venous drainage for any organ is important. So veins are here, it's thin walled. They are valveless and mainly drain into the dural venous sinuses. Usually you have studied in many other parts the veins have got valves, but here they have lack of valves. And mainly there are three sets of veins. They are called to the cerebral hemisphere, then to the brain stem, and to the cerebellum. And again the cerebral veins has been divided to superficial and deep veins. The superficial veins mainly supply the cortex and the subcortical white matter. Deep veins mainly supply the deep nuclei like basal ganglia and diencephalon. So coming to the superficial veins, so this is the image showing the superficial veins. Mainly they are superior cerebral, then you have the superficial middle cerebral and inferior cerebral. Among the superficial veins, there are three veins, that is called as superior cerebral, then superficial middle cerebral, and inferior cerebral. So superior cerebral, there are 8 to 12 in number. They collect blood from mainly from the supralateral and medial surface, which ultimately drains into the superior sagittal sinus. So where is the superior sagittal sinus? They present in the fox cerebra of the pleural fold, in the upper border of the fox cerebra. And superficial cerebral vein mainly drains from the lateral surface into the cavernous sinus. Then inferior cerebral veins drain from the inferior surface and ventral part of inferior, ventral part of lateral surface. Coming to the deep veins. Deep veins are called as internal cerebral vein. It is formed by union of thalamus rhyoid and choroid veins and mainly joins to form what we call as great cerebral vein of Galen. And ultimately terms, this is the great cerebral vein of Galen. And ultimately drains into the straight sinus. This is the straight sinus, which mainly drains the deep structures of the forebrain. So then this image you can make out. This is superior cervical sinus, inferior cervical sinus, this is straight sinus, and this is the thalamus rhyoidal vein, and this is intercerebral vein, and this is the vein of Galen, cavernous sinus, sigmoid sinus because of the S-shape, which continues as jugular vein. So great cerebral vein of Galen, it's about 2 cm long, formed by 2 internal cerebral veins below the sternum. Mainly, there are tributaries as basal vein, internal veins, occipital vein, and posterior callosum veins. So veins of specific areas are midbrain, mainly drained by the great cerebral vein as well as basal vein. Pons mainly by the basal and cerebellar vein. Middle oblongata, anterior and posterior spinal veins, which corresponds to the arteries. Then cerebellum is mainly drained by the great cerebral vein of Galen. So this is about the arterial supply of the blood and the blood supply of the cerebral hemispheres as well as the important parts of the brain along the brain stem. Any doubts in this part before I go to the next topic?
If anyone have any doubt on arterial supply and venous drainage, you may kindly ask.
I hope yesterday they have gone through the study material.
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah.
Any feedback about it? It's just crisp highlights of each session.
Okay, ma'am. Actually, they have seen the YouTube videos.
Yeah.
Today by evening, I'll give you the feedback of that. I didn't ask specific.
They can ask in the chat box if they have any doubts.
Yeah. Okay.
Go to the next, because it will be too much if they do continuously. So let me stop at this point. Then I can continue.
Yeah. So if anyone have any doubt regarding the blood supply and venous drainage, you may kindly ask.
I think for them also, circular fillets will be asked a short notes question.
Circular fillets. Actually, right now I got that question also. Can you explain circular fillets once more, ma'am?
Circular fillets once more. This is the image showing the circular fillets. So we have studied that the entire brain is supplied by 2 systems of arteries, that is the internal cavity and vertebral arteries, 2 vertebral arteries. So these two the branches coming from these 2 arteries, they form a circle in the base of the brain, we call it a circular fillets. So it is formed anteriorly by the anterior cerebral artery, which is the branch of internal cavity. These 2 anteriors cerebral artery are in turn joined by anticommunicating artery. this one, and you have this intercalated artery. Then you have the posterior communicating artery joining the posterior cerebral artery, and the behind is joined by two posterior cerebral artery completing the circle. So this is the circle of Willis. So each of this circle of Willis again has got branches which supplies the on deeper nuclei of the cortex. Something else?
Yeah, ma'am. One more question came in the chat box.
Yeah.
Ma'am, can you explain basilar artery once more?
Basilar artery is nothing but the joining part of two vertebral arteries in the portomedullary junction and in the basilar part of the basilar groove of the pons. It forms a basilar artery. The two vertebral arteries join together to form the basilar artery. In turn, gives many branches to the brainstem. So here you can make out the two vertebral arteries joining to form the basilar artery.
Ma'am, anterior cerebral artery and its branches.
So the anterior cerebral artery is a branch coming from the intercalated artery. So it mainly comes to the medial surface of the cerebral hemisphere and gives many branches. So the important one are the recurrent artery of Tubner, which supplies the intercapsule, and you have the orbital branch, frontopolar branch, then callosal branch. It mainly supplies the medial surface of the brain or the cortex. So this highlighted part is from the anterior cerebral artery. Anything else?
Yeah, ma'am. What are confluence of sinuses in venous drainage?
The confluences of sinuses are nothing but the anastomosis taking part where the veins come and meet. That's called as confluence of sinuses. So you can make out here. So many veins come and meet here. This is called as confluence of sinuses. So the superior sinus, inferior sinus, straight sinus, they all come and meet here. That's called as confluence of sinuses. The part you can take out now. This is the confluence of sinuses.
Ma'am, can you explain the position of superior and inferior sagittal sinus?
The superior sagittal sinus is present on the superior border of the fox cerebri. So there's a yesterday I told about the four dural folds of the fox cerebri, the dentorum cerebelli, the fox cerebelli, and diaphanous cerebelli. The most important one is the fox cerebelli, which is sickle shape. So in the superior border, you find the superior sagittal sinus, and in the inferior border, you find the inferior sagittal sinus. This is our fox cerebelli, which separates the two cerebral hemispheres.
I think, ma'am, there are no further questions. You can proceed.
So I can proceed to the next part, that is called as cerebellum. So cerebellum is also called as hindbrain, part of the hindbrain, also called as little brain. And it has got two hemispheres joined by the vermis. So morphologically, functionally, delphinally it has been classified. So it's called little brain and its largest part of fine brain situated in the posterior cuneiform fossa below the tentorium cerebelli. So this tentorium cerebelli demarcates the occipital lobe of cerebrum from the cerebellum. And it's connected to the brainstem by what we call as peduncles. So to the brain is connected to the superior cerebellar peduncle, to the pons, to the middle cerebellar peduncle, and to the medulla, it is inferior cerebellar peduncle. through afferents and efferents pass through these peduncles. So, as I told you yesterday, the entire brain is formed by two things, which is gray matter and white matter. So, here the white matter is thrown into folia. So, this is like an arborvitae tree pattern. So, you can make out this white matter and thin gray matter. Coming to subdivisions of cerebellum, so there are two large bilateral hemispheres joined by the vermis. So it has got horizontal fissure, and this demarcates the superior surface from the inferior surface. So this horizontal fissure demarcates superior surface from the inferior surface of the cerebellum. Then you have the posterior lateral fissure. The posterior lateral fissure here, this posterior lateral fissure separates the posterior surface from what we call as flocculum nodular lobe. Flocculum nodular lobe. And it's a primary fissure, like a V-shaped primary fissure, which demarcates anterior lobe from the posterior lobe in the superior surface itself. So these are the divisions. That is the anterior lobe, posterior lobe, and flocculum nodular lobe. So anterior lobe and posterior lobe is demarcated by primary fissure. And the posterior lobe from the flocculum nodular lobe is demarcated by posterior lateral fissure. So this is the side view. So this is anterior view, anterior lobe, and this is the posterior lobe. And this is the primary fissure. And here you can take for the posterior lateral fissure. So the pair of flocculi and the nodule of vermis both are connected by the peduncles. So here the different colors are given. So this is anterior lobe, and posterior lobe is quite big, and the smaller one is a flocculi nodular lobe. So what are the divisions in the anterior lobe? So it forms mainly part of the superior surface. In the vermis, you have what we call as lingula, this is the central lobule, and culmen. Lingula, central lobule, and culmen. And then in the hemisphere, you have the vela, quadrangular lobule. This forms the anterior lobe. So these are the parts in the anterior lobe. So what are the posterior lobe? So the posterior lobe have mainly the superior cerebellar lobule, inferior cerebellar lobule, and biventral lobule with the tonsil. And what are the parts in the vermis? They are folium, tuber, pyramid, cumulum. The most smallest part is the flocculum nodular lobe, with having the flocculus and the nodule in the vermis. So these are the divisions in the vermis as well as the hemisphere in anterior posterior lobe. So what is a morphological subdivision? So morphological is divided to archicerebellum, paleocerebellum, and neocerebellum. Archi means old. Paleo is medium. And neo is new, where it is evolved in the human beings with the skillful movements. So archicerebellum is the first to appear in evolution, and mostly it is well developed in the fishes. So it mainly includes the flocculum nodular lobe here. And the function is to maintain some equilibrium, tone, and posture of trunk muscles. Because the fishes are very skilled swimming, it has to maintain the posture and equilibrium. So the flocculum nodular lobe is well developed. Next comes the paleocerebellum. The paleocerebellum appears next to terrestrial vertebrates, that is amphibians, then superimposed on dorsally of the archicerebellum, and this part, the posterior lobe forms the paleocerebellum and helps in the maintenance of muscle tone and posture of the limbs. And also the planning of voluntary activity is possible in this paleocerebellum. Now come to neocerebellum. So neocerebellum the most two cerebellar cortex along with the dentate nucleus, and they present in all the vertebrae. So this pink color, the most anterior lobe, is forms a neocerebellum, which helps in the regulation of muscle tone, coordination of skilled voluntary movement. It also helps in the smooth performance of skilled acts by coordination of movements. This is very, very important in vertebrates or in mammals. So functions of these cortex. So functions subdivisions mainly longitudinally it been divided to median, paramedian, and lateral. So this is a median, here is a paramedian, and this is a lateral. So median zone, this is the median zone where you find the vermis, which will be concerned with the movements of trunk, extensions of muscle and tone, vestibular spinal and reticulospinal tract passes through this. The intermediate zone is pink color. So mainly it's in the postural control of axillary limb muscles for progression of gait. The lateral zone is blue color, regulates the coordination of distal limb muscles for skillful prehensile acts as such a neocerebellum. Coming to the cerebellar nuclei. So the cerebellar nuclei are the core in number, called as dentate nucleus. Then you have the emboliformis, globuses, and testiculi. So it is like crumpled back shape is the largest one, is the dentate nucleus. It also resembles like inferior olivary nucleus present in the medulla. So these are the four deep cerebellar nuclei present in the cerebellum. So coming to the peduncles, so peduncles are mainly the inferior cerebellar peduncle, passes through the cerebellum and dorsolateralis to the medulla. Then you have the middle cerebellar peduncle, then you have the superior cerebellar peduncle to the midbrain. What are the main functions of the cerebellum? As I told you, there is the maintenance of posture, maintenance of muscle tone, and coordination of voluntary and skillful acts of the body. So blood supply, as we studied, is mainly from the basilar artery. So the superior cerebellar artery, the anterior inferior cerebellar artery, and posterior inferior cerebellar artery, coming from the basilar artery, they supply the cerebellum. Coming to the applied aspect, so if this ischemic damage to these arteries due to lack of blood supply, it causes what is called cerebellar syndrome. It may be the archaic cerebellum or the pale cerebellum or the neocerebellum. And they're called as cerebellar syndromes. So archaic cerebellum, it leads to truncal ataxia and staggering gait. Then it causes nystagmus. What is this nystagmus? Involuntary movements of the eyeball is called as nystagmus, and this is a truncal ataxic bleeding. Then the paleocerebellum, if it is damaged, it causes hypotonia and disturbed tendon reflexes. So in physiology, we do what we call as biceps tendon reflex and the major that will be impaired in case of paleocerebellum. So these are the images showing the cerebellar syndrome. Then coming to neocerebellum, it's called as dysmetria. That is, if the person wants to point the tip of the nose, it may be overshooting or it may not reach the destiny. Then intentional tremors. Tremors are nothing but involuntary movements of the hand. Then dysgyrokinesis. Dysgyrokinesis is a you can't do the supination and pronation. Then dysarthria, because of loss of the speech. So this is the finger pointing test. Dysgyrokinesia, gait ataxia. You cannot walk in straight path. Then the postural tree for position sense, and this is the dysmetria, and this is for nystagmus. So these are the important features of each of the cerebellar syndrome. Thank you. Mr. Kalu?
Yes, ma'am.
So this was about the cerebellum.
Yeah.
I'm not going in depth about the tracts because that will be taught in physiology.
So yeah, ma'am.
If they learn anatomy with correlation with the physiology, they can understand the tracts.
Yeah, ma'am.
What is white matter?
Ma'am, you explained various zones of cerebellum. Can you repeat that slide again?
Various?
Zones.
Zones. So functional division, subdivisions of cerebellum, cerebellar hemisphere, classified into median zone, then intermediate zone, and lateral zone. So each of these zones have got different activities. So the median zone mainly concerned this green color is a median, pink is a intermediate, and lateral is a blue color. The median zone concerns the movements of trunk and extensor muscle toe. Intermediate zone ends in the posterior control of the axial and limb muscles. And lateral zone mainly concerned with the coordination of distal limb muscles for skillful prehensile acts. These are the different zones of the cerebellar hemispheres.
Ma'am, one more question came.
Yeah.
Can you please repeat the fissures of cerebellum?
First is a primary fissure. So primary fissure is a V-shaped fissure which demarcates the anterior lobe and posterior lobe. In the posterior lobe only there is a horizontal fissure. This demarcates the superior surface from the inferior surface. Then you have the posterior lateral fissure which separates the posterior lobe from the flocculo nodular lobe. So these are the three important fissures. Yes.
If any other question, further questions are there, you may please ask. Ma'am, regarding the blood supply.
Yes.
Is there different blood supply for all fissures or it is the same? Like maybe for lobes.
Lobes. Current blood supply mainly by the superior cerebellar artery. Yes, there will be different blood supply for maybe for the artery cerebellum is different, radio is different, and nervous cerebellum is different. And each of these minor artery if they are blocked, it leads to the cerebellar syndrome.
And venous drainage of cerebellum.
Venous drainage of cerebellum is the same which corresponds to the veins. Like there will be anterior cerebellar vein, posterior cerebellar vein, which corresponds to the arteries. In any of the organs, in the corresponding veins corresponding arteries, it will be the same.
One more question is there in the chat box, ma'am.
Yeah.
Can you please explain peduncles again?
Peduncles. So peduncles are the inward the connections between the brainstem and cerebellum. See, whatever the traps coming from the spinal cord, it will pass through the cerebellum, integrates, then pass upwards. So there is a superior cerebellar peduncle connecting the midbrain. The middle cerebellar peduncle connecting the palms. And inferior cerebellar peduncle to the medulla oblongata. So these peduncles, afferents and efferents pass through the brainstem and the cerebellum. There is importance of peduncles.
Ma'am, you mentioned about something like arbor vitae. Can you explain that again?
See, there will be gray matter and white matter. The white matter in this cerebellar hemisphere, each of the hemisphere is cut and open. It resembles the arbor vitae three pattern. That's why it's called as arbor vitae. This three pattern that resemblance is mentioned here.
Any other further questions? Ma'am, how cerebellum is attached to the brainstem?
To the peduncles. Totally, no? To the peduncles, it is attached to the brainstem. Peduncles are like supporting and well connecting the intensive connection of fibers.
Any other questions? No, ma'am, I'm not receiving any further questions. I hope you are also not getting messages. Yes, Ms. Akriti Chaudhary.
Yeah, she raised her hand. Unmute yourself and ask.
Akriti Chaudhary, you raised your hand. If you have any doubt, you can ask. Ma'am, more kind of physiology question came. I hope you will be comfortable with that. How cerebellum help in maintenance of equilibrium?
Maintenance of?
Equilibrium.
So mainly the popliteal nodular lobe. Popliteal nodular lobe is maintained in the maintenance of equilibrium. Mainly through the vestibular tracts. So the vestibular nuclei is present in the medulla. So there will be connection to the what you call as vestibular cerebellar tract. So that tract. It helps in the maintenance of equilibrium. And it is well developed in case of fishes to maintain the posture and equilibrium. That's it for us, RP cerebellum. Anything else?
Any other doubts? One more question came, ma'am. So you told the zones of cerebellum are actually divided or they are differentiated on basis of the function. Ma'am, can you hear me? Ma'am, am I audible?